Okay, great. Thank you so much for that, Lee. I didn't put in here a lot about my background, so I won't go into a lot of that, but I changed my title because I decided that I want to talk a little bit about my research and best practices for invasive species control in grasslands for you know, what we're dealing with here in Texas. But I also want to go into dealing with exotic species and native species and what's going on as we approach climate change and working in a novel world. So those are the kinds of things I wanted to talk about tonight. This will be interactive, so let me see why my screen, there we go. So I will be polling you throughout part of the talk. So you'll need to go to this website. It's poll EV, it's pollev.com. It stands for poll everywhere. And then / Lyons Kelly 863. And this will be on every slide that comes up where I'm going to be polling. This address will be on there, so you won't lose it. And you can do this through your computer, through your web browser, or you can do it on your phone through your web browser. The phone's kind of fun. Students do it all the time with their phone, but you can also use your computer. So you'd have to toggle back and forth between this talk and your web browser. So I'll just give everybody just a few seconds to get that address.
Kelly, would you mind saying that address again, please?
Sure. It's poll. Can you not see the screen? I'll put it in the chat.
I'm sorry. I'm not seeing this screen, but I think I messed up my viewing option.
Okay.
Fred, are you seeing the screen? The
screen is fine. You can see it well. And the address is up there.
Thank you.
Okay. I'm going to put it in the chat just in case. There you go. So once you get your stuff together, maybe that'll.
I think it's just me, Kelly.
Don't worry about it. I get it. Totally get it. Okay. All right. So just a brief outline for the talk. I want to talk about restoration as biocontrol. This is something I've been interested in doing for a long time since I came to Texas, and I had a big USDA grant many years ago to do this work. And then we hit the exceptional drought, and I've been sort of tracking the progress of that research project for a long time. So I want to report on that. And then I want to talk about novel world questions. And it's basically kind of getting at my existential crisis with native species. So here's the first poll everywhere slide. So you can see the poll everywhere address above. And I just want to make sure, you know, there are people out there and that you're paying attention. So using your computer, click on your current location on the image. If you're not in San Antonio, just click on the right corner. So once people start clicking, then you can see that the points start dropping, and it's kind of fun with images to use this. So some of you are way on the north side. Some of you guys are downtown, mid-north side. Some inside the loop. I'm totally inside the loop. So I'm gonna give everybody a few more seconds here just to weigh in. Since there's 38 of you, this suggests that about half of you are interacting with this, so that's fine. I just want to see how many people are able to do this approximately. Okay, so I'm going to go to the next slide. So we've got quite a few people who have mastered this. So that's terrific. So I wanted to talk a little bit about my research. In my PhD work, I studied how diversity influences invasion processes, and I was sort of in this this very dangerous area of science that where we ask questions like, does diversity matter? And so it didn't really occur to me, I was in my 20s, right, when I did my PhD, and it didn't really occur to me that, you know, what if diversity doesn't matter? So anyway, in the end, I did this relatively large experiment up in the Sierra Nevadas, where I altered diversity in those sites, and then I introduced an invasive species to see if it established or not. And this was with a species that I'm going to talk about towards the end of the talk, Lolium temulentum, which is ryegrass, an annual Mediterranean grass that people have been introducing all over Texas. And the basic question was, if you alter diversity, or if you reduce diversity, does that make communities more susceptible to invasion? So I'll talk in a minute about what I found. I then went, and I also studied during this time, during my PhD, I studied barbed goat grass. I don't know if any of you know barbed goat grass. It's a close relative of wheat. And it grows on serpentine soil, among other unusual soil types. And it was introduced to California, and it was threatening these serpentine soils that harbor a lot of incredibly beautiful endemics, and very rare endemics, some of them, in throughout California. So I studied this grass, and it, we did find that the species was unusually just pre-evolved to deal with serpentine soil and was doing well in those soils. I then did my postdoctoral work in Sonora, Mexico, and I was studying Penicillium ciliare. You probably are familiar with this grass. This is buffel grass. As you go from San Antonio, drive down towards the coast, you'll see it everywhere. It's actually pretty good forage for cattle, and it has really transformed much of the desert, both the Chihuahuan Desert and the Sonoran Desert, but I found it as far south as Oaxaca, so it's been introduced very widely for cattle. But I studied the effects of this grass on the persistence of native species in the Sonoran Desert. It's kind of a nice study because there's very little data in this region of the world because it's so dang hot and pokey and awful to collect data. So it's actually been a well-cited and successful work. Then the work, when I came back to Texas, I am actually from San Antonio. I came back to Texas. When I grew up here, I wasn't a botanist, and I came back as a botanist when I took the job at Trinity University. And I started trying to apply some of the things that I had learned in my PhD and my postdoc to how to do better restoration. So, you know, somebody had messed with Texas, the grasslands were, even though they were perennial grasslands, a lot of the native perennials had been replaced with non-native perennials. And so I wanted to start studying, well, how could we use post removal, you remove an invasive species, but what do you do after you remove the invasive species to keep the invasive species out? So I call that restoration as biocontrol. And I wanted to figure out, you know, which species to be using and what combinations and those kinds of things. So this is all predicated on this very, very theoretical work called biodiversity ecosystem functioning work. And this figure comes right out of a paper that I wrote with my PhD thesis advisor, Mark Schwartz, where you have biodiversity on the x-axis and you have any ecosystem process on the y-axis. This can be invasion resistance, it can be erosion control, nutrient cycling, carbon retention, which we're really, really interested in now. And we generally find that as you increase diversity, or as diversity is maintained in an ecosystem at high levels of diversity, you have higher ecosystem functioning. And again, this can be really important for carbon sequestration and carbon uptake, because systems that are more diverse tend to be more productive. And I was interested in how diversity again influenced the invasion processes. But we find that, you know, this type A curve is the one we really want to see, right? Every single species matters. In a curve like this one, like this type B, there's a lot of redundancy. So after you get to a certain level, maybe all these species up here, maybe they don't matter so much. So those are kind of the basic questions of my research. And what we found over and over again in communities where we had manipulated diversity, we found that as diversity increased, the fitness or the establishment or the percent cover of whatever you wanted to measure of the invasive species went down. So, and this was very consistent throughout many of the works that were done at that time. I'm going to check the chat because I can see that there's some. Okay. We seem to be okay. Again, so getting back to this paper, I'm just going to pull one figure out of this paper to show you. This was sort of the take home. This shows you that on the x-axis, you can see where we experimentally imposed richness. I just totally messed up my, okay, where we experimentally imposed richness. So I removed species and I was able to manipulate the site so that there were either very few species in a plot or a lot of species in a plot. This is a very actually low diversity site. And I found that this species that we introduced, this annual ryegrass, did better when there were fewer species and did worse when there were more species. And actually it was a more of a rare species study because I focused primarily on the rare species first. So even in these low diversity sites, you're gonna have more common species, and up here you're gonna have more of the rare species. So the study also showed that even less common species can have an effect on invasion resistance. So that was the basic take home of that study. So what we find in general is that within a community, sites with higher species diversity have higher ecosystem functioning. And we think the mechanism is complementarity. Sometimes I show this in slides, but I can just explain it to you that when you start to lose species, you start to open up niche space where other species can start to invade. So generally we think of as a community as a very tight-knit co-evolved group of species that work together. They all have different functional types and they're all kind of duking it out until they come into some sort of balance with the competition between them. And when you lose a species, you lose that complementarity that species have, and you release nutrients, you open light, light availability, space availability, those kinds of things. So you lose the complementarity that exists in very intact ecosystems. So by extension, we suggest that sites that have higher species diversity will be more resistant to invasion. And by further extension, higher diversity restored plant communities would be more resistant to invasion too. So the idea is that, you know, if we can, we don't just put one species in there, we want to put multiple species, and then which species will we use? The converse of this is another theory that species with really high biomass have the largest ecosystem effects. So the species that is the most dominant species will be the one that is the biggest driver of the, how the ecosystem operates. This is called the mass ratio hypothesis. So by extension, highest biomass species will be the most effective at deterring invasive species establishment. So you have like diversity or you have really abundant competitive species. So which one is it going to be? Is diversity going to be the driver, or is it the really competitive dominant species? So when I'm writing this paper, I'm actually posing those two theories at odds with each other. In the end, you'll find that actually both matter. Okay, so what drove this major experiment was these questions. So can rangeland restoration serve as invasive species biocontrol? And I focused on this as these as rangeland systems as potential for forage because it was a USDA grant and that's what they really care about is ag systems, right? So I wanted to know, okay, which species should we be using and how many species should we be using and which combinations of species might we use? And then a later question that's come up now is like, in what temporal, when should you put them in? Should one come after another? Those are things I'm gonna be asking later. So you probably are all familiar with sites that look like this one right in the middle. This is a KR bluestem site, KR bluestem dominant site. And now that I've seen this picture, it may have some Australian bluestem and also a little bit of clayburgh. But anyway, most people just look at a field like that and they think KR bluestem unless you're south of San Antonio. So it's a perennial bunch grass. It's C4, right? It's a warm season grass. It came from Eurasia. It was part of this huge accession of several species, probably four species. It was introduced here in the United States for rangeland improvement and erosion control, but now it's found throughout the Southwest and the Midwest. It's relatively low forage value, but still at least it's soil stabilizing and it was useful, especially during the drought, the extreme drought that we had in the 1950s. It does homogenize sites, many sites, especially those sites that are heavily disturbed and have a long history of grazing. And one of the tricky things about managing it is that you're managing a C4 grass in a C4 grassland. So you've got a warm season grass and you want to replace it with other warm season grasses, which means it likely has an overlapping niche in the way that it utilizes resources in space and time. So it's a hard thing to try to figure out how to replace. So what we did is we worked with the Nature Conservancy to do a prescribed burn to remove the species because I'm not a big fan of herbicides and I wanted to do it as naturally as possible. And we had done an initial study. You can see I caught this in a Google image. Initial study where we were trying to get the landowner more comfortable with burning the property. And so we did burn boxes and it was so much fun that it got captured in a Google image up here. And so we did the burn boxes up here. And then we did the big experiment down here in these open fields. When we burned the site, this is what it looked like, and it was a perfect burn. It really kicked back the KR, and then it got super cold, and so it was really a perfect slate to start with restoration project that was designed to study how well we could control KR. What we did was we just used four different species of grasses. And one of my dreams in the whole world was to do an experiment where we had all possible richness combinations, meaning numbers of species. So this one had 1, 2, 3, and 4 species and all possible treatment combinations, meaning we had all the species alone, all the species and all possible two species combinations, three species combinations, and then of course all four species together. So if you know anything about math and factorial designs, you know that this actually, the number of replicates that you have to have and plots you need to have to do this starts to increase like in a crazy way. So we were able to do it with four species. We did a randomized complete block design for those of you who care. And then we had six individuals per plot. And this is showing you a plot with, sorry, 16 individuals. And this was one of my favorite plots because this is all Indian grass that came in, and you can see all 16 individuals planted in a grid. And then we systematically replaced them when we went out, when we did combinations. Okay, so these were the big four that we used. We used big blue stem, little blue stem, side oats grandma, and Indian grass. So I'll be using these abbreviations, BBS, LBS, SOG, and YIG. I know this group doesn't need that much help with these. And then I just planted some single species plots just using green sprangle top, purple threon, and silver blue stem. Green sprangle top wasn't my favorite go-to species because it's so early successional, it kind of disappears after a while, and it's kind of same for purple threon, and neither of them are considered super great forage value grasses. And the silver blue stem, as much as I love it, and I wanted to use it because it's the same genus as KR blue stem, and I think it does outcompete KR and under a lot of circumstances, it doesn't germinate very well for us. So we're still working on that, but it has done quite well in this site. All right, so this shows you how well the species established in the first year. So this was looking at summer 2010. And those of you who were around at this time may remember that there was a huge drought that hit right after this summer 2010. So this was, you know, I put this experiment in and then the drought hit, and I remember thinking, wow, that was a lot of money put in for a big drought. And so it kind of became a drought experiment. Well, it totally became a drought experiment, which is fine with me because we're going to be seeing a lot more drought in the future, and we want to know how to do restoration in a drought. So you can see the establishment for big blue stem, little blue stem, side oats grandma, and yellow Indian grass was terrific. Less so for green sprangle top and purple threon, but silver blue stem did really well. Then the exceptional drought hits, and fall of 2012, this is what it looked like. So side oats grandma here, and everything else kind of dropped down. And so what I've been doing is following it, this experiment carefully since then, to figure out what's happened after this exceptional drought. And I just got in the chat, I saw that somebody wanted a copy of my research. You can reach me at Trinity, and I can send you, also happy to send anybody copies. I'm also happy to provide Fred or Lee copies of all these papers. So always happy to do that. Okay, so this shows you what happened through time. So this is Andropogon, this is big blue stem here, little blue stem, Indian grass here on the bottom left, and then side oats grandma here. So you can see they do pretty well. The exceptional drought hits. This is pretty much a trend. And then we just kind of tracking them through time. Side oats grandma has, without a doubt, done better than the rest of them. You can see that the y-axes are not the same and all these. That's kind of not a very good idea to do that. But these three have established and substantially and stuck and have substantially lower coverage than side oats. But I have to say, I've been impressed with how well they do in competing against KR bluestem. And I'll show you that right now. So this shows you the effect of richness, which means just how diverse are the plots. So I have zero to five species, four, it's really just four species on this x-axis, and then the invasive species percent cover. And you can see that when you increase richness in the plots, and this is looking at 2017, the establishment of, or the reestablishment of the invasive species goes down. Now, if you have the zero in there, it actually is a much more robust finding, but we still have a significant finding, marginally significant finding, when we can include when we take the zero out. The zero is leveraging this quite a bit. But if you don't do anything, you get a lot of KR. When you start to add one, two, three, or four species, you start to decrease the amount of KR that you get in the plots, which is good news. Now, this is showing you kind of complicated data, but I want to go through it really quickly because it is really important. The Dean-Min measurement is designed to assess the effect of a combination of species on the invasive reestablishment relative to the most suppressive species alone. So the most suppressive species alone, if you look at all these, there's big blue stem, little blue stem, side oats grandma, and yellow Indian grass. The most suppressive species is side oats grandma here. So this is looking at by percent cover. And if you look at relative percent cover, it's the same. We have this really low amount of KR blue stem in the side oats grandma. But the question is should we just rely on side oats grandma, or should we be using a many species combinations, right? And so these that are suppressing Cytotes gramma, excuse me, suppressing KR bluestem to these low numbers here and over here too, this suggests that these species combinations are working better than Cytotes gramma alone, which is kind of fun to see. So you can see here, like if you plant all four of them, that's pretty suppressive. Just yellow Indian grass, Cytotes gramma, and big little bluestem. Yellow Indian grass, big bluestem, Cytotes gramma. These are much more suppressive than Cytotes gramma alone. But Cytotes gramma does pretty well. So this was in 2011. So then by 2017, you can see what happens is the most suppressive species that's operating alone, is actually doing a little better than the more diverse plots. So over here, the diverse plots are suppressing KR bluestem, but not as much as Cytotes gramma on its own. So this suggests that for early, if you want to get early suppression, you might use multiple species. If you want to just have long-term suppression, you might use Cytotes gramma. Of course, this is all predicated on, this exceptional drought situation. But I'm not surprised by this because Cytotes gramma has become my go-to for suppression of KR bluestem, at least at the onset. So then my question becomes, okay, so you get Cytotes gramma in there, you suppress KR bluestem, then what comes after that? And that'll be the subject of a lot of research going into the future. And so this is just showing you that if you can get native species established, you can suppress KR. So where the restored species percent cover is really high, you have very low establishment of KR bluestem. So that's the good news, that if you can just get stuff established, you can keep KR out. So there might be a question here. Okay, so who's asking the question? Somebody's asking a question about burn time. So I've written several papers on burn time and how to control KR bluestem, and I have very strong opinions about this, but we burned in October, and my preference is to burn when KR is either in the soft dough stage or is in the boot, like flowering, somewhere in the flowering process, where as much of the carbohydrates that are below ground have been mobilized above ground, and there's enough dry biomass to burn it. I think that's the best time to burn. We've had all sorts of the data that we've collected and the papers that we've published are kind of all over the place, but we've definitely found that anything other than winter when everything's dormant is better than a dormant season burn. So that's when we burned. I really wanted to get burning in fall. That was my goal, is to do it in fall when it's fully flowering. So in summary, something is better than nothing. Plant something. You can't get out there and expect to herbicide or burn KR bluestem and that's going to solve your problems. It's just not going to happen. Establishment works. Native species establishment is negatively correlated with reinvasion. Both the big species, the really abundant species, and diversity work. So just depends on what your goal is. And long-term establishment and drought effects need to be considered. And with the reinvasion suppression as a goal, serious consideration has to be given to what we call priority effects. So again, the timing of when you put everything in the ground. Oh, soft dough. So the soft dough stage is when seeds are forming when the seed is forming inside of the ovary, the seeds go through a time when the endosperm is really soft and liquidy, and then it hardens up. So you know most seeds that you eat are hard. Well, they don't start like that. They start really soft. So that's called the soft dough stage. In the boot is when the inflorescence is in the stem and it hasn't popped out yet. So it's a fun one. It's very Texan. It's in the boot. Okay, so the second part of my talk, I want to get into these kind of more fun and philosophical questions. Maybe not so philosophical, but for a lot of people they are. Why natives and why not exotics? And what's an invasive species anyway? So one of the reasons I've been getting into this discussion is because I've been helping out, consult with the new Guadalupe Gardens, and this is a plug for Guadalupe Gardens. It's going to be a nursery and a bar. It's out at the old Schultz Nursery in Marion, Texas, and it's going to be owned and run by Chuck Hildebrand with her new team. And Chuck and I went round and round about should we do all natives? And she really is going to do all natives, with the exception of vegetable crop plants, which will be seasonal, and then also some apothecary, those kinds of things that will be done. I can talk about the KR suppression later. It does last. It has been static and going down. And the plots where species have established, the native species have established, it is sufficiently suppressed, undoubtedly. Okay, so Chuck and I have been going around about whether the her nursery should be completely native or not. And we're both very, very dedicated to natives. And we decided yes, and we're both very dedicated. And this is something we want to do. And I'm in there with her, and she's really doing all the hard work. But it's going to be a really terrific endeavor, and I'm really excited for her. But this question of why natives, why not exotics, I think is a good one. So I just want to do this real quick, a poll, and I'm going to have to do it pretty quickly because we're going to run out of time. But name a non-invasive exotic species that grows or is grown in Central Texas. So with your poll everywhere, you can go in and you can type an answer to this question. Okay, bougainvillea, China berry. These are invasive exotics. Okay, crepe myrtle can be exotic. Pride of Barbados can be exotic for sure. I mean, it can be invasive. Ligustrum, I think that's what that's supposed to be. Yeah, that can definitely. Red tip fatina can be invasive. Nandina. So these are ones. I see. I'm sorry. I'm getting. What did I just do? Word. Hang on. Okay, China berry, I would say, is exotic and invasive. Bougainvillea, right, that is exotic and not invasive. Crepe myrtle, right, exotic, not invasive, good. Ligustrum, I would say, is invasive. Pride of Barbados, right, non-invasive, exotic, at least in our area. Red tip fatina, also not invasive and exotic. Nandina is considered invasive, actually. I don't know that one. Somebody will have to tell me what that one is. Vitex is actually considered invasive, but and it's exotic. Tree of Heaven in many places. Ailanthus is invasive, maybe not here. Okay, so you get the idea. So let's do this one. Name an invasive exotic species that grows in Central Texas. Chinese, yes, that's a great one. If you ever lived in the Houston area going towards East Texas, it's just the bane of any restoration ecologist. Yes, I'm glad you mentioned Mexican petunia. I wish we'd stop selling it. China berry, yep, that's a good one. Yep, absolutely. Really invasive. Ligustrum, also invasive, exotic. Right, so, and I agree that Nandina is exotic, is invasive as well. I don't know, Queen's Cat Clown. These are good, these are new to me. I'm gonna have to look them up. Chinese tallow, yeah. Let's do one more, maybe. Ailanthus, Tree of Heaven, yep. Yep. Okay. So these are the woody ones. Now name an invasive native species that grows in Central Texas. This is harder, right? Okay, didn't expect to get no answers, but I did expect there would be very few. Well,
our official Native Plant Society of Texas definition is that a native plant cannot be invasive. It can be aggressive.
That's right. And I disagree with that. So let's go on with the next poll. Okay. Here's the definition of exotic by the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service. I want to know if you think this is correct. An exotic species is any species, including its seed, egg, spores, or other biological material capable of propagating that species that is not native to that habitat. So you can weigh in here. Does this seem like a reasonable definition? Okay, well, this seems to be, let me see how many people have answered. Some people say no. Okay, let's go to the next one. So here's the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service definition of native. A native species is a species that, other than as a result of introduction, historically occurs or occurred in that particular habitat. Okay, so most people agree with that one. And here's the one that I find problematic. where the definition of an invasive comes in. An invasive species is an exotic species whose introduction into an ecosystem in which it is not native causes or is likely to cause environmental or economic harm or harm to human health. Right, some people become very divided on this, like what do you call an invasive? And my feeling is that it's very dangerous to start hedging or splitting hairs on invasive, aggressive, because if an invasive species causes harm or environmental harm, economic harm, harm to human health, then they're all invasive to a degree. And this is so I cannot decide. It's really a fine answer there. I understand that. So for the most part, people who study invasive species categorize them one way or another. But here's a real problem. Well, let me just get back to the definition. So most invasive species are exotic species, right? The vast majority. And as a matter of fact, this review that came out in the Annual Review of Ecology and Systematics didn't even distinguish an invasive species from an exotic species. I mean, the vast majority of invasive species are exotic species. And here you can see that if something is considered invasive, it's basically exotic and it's introduced from somewhere else. Okay, so they didn't really even distinguish. But where I get really concerned is I'm missing a slide. I'm missing the slide where, and I might come up in a minute, where some people are using exotic species for restoration because they think it can be helpful. And that is a real problem when we start to think about using exotics that way. So some natives can be invasive, and I think most of us consider, even though this new book came out about Wanted Dead or Alive with ash juniper, I think a lot of us consider ash juniper to be an invasive species. I mean, granted, it's become invasive because of our change in the way that we manage ecosystems, but it is a species that is treated as invasive and is removed as invasive and is tackled as invasive. So this is a native invasive species, and there aren't very many of them in the world like that, but they do exist. And you might say that's an aggressive species, but if it's homogenizing and damaging to human health ecosystems, those kinds of things, then I would argue that we need to call it invasive. Oh, I'm sorry, I didn't take your answer, Norma. Okay, good. Good to know that somebody was listening, or somebody had an idea. All right, so I want to talk a little about some of the conflict here with this, and I love this story so much about cochineal. So most of you are, I'm sure, familiar with cochineal, this scale insect that grows on prickly pear cactus, and it can be used, it's been cultivated widely throughout Mesoamerica down into South America because it's such a great dye. And I don't know if any of you have ever, I've dyed Easter eggs with it. You can get pinks and reds and purples, and it's a complete blast, right, to use cochineal. We can talk about my classification of ash juniper in a bit. Let me get back to that. So the fun thing about this story, of course, is that it's, you know, widely used. It's extremely valuable. Europeans come to the New World and they discover it, and they discover its utility. And there's a lot of suggestion that the British adopted the use of cochineal for dyeing redcoats. And then that's one of the reasons that it gets introduced into places like Australia. So the cactus is introduced to Australia with the cochineal, and then the cactus becomes completely and utterly dominant across the landscape, and it just wrecks millions and millions of acres of rangeland. And this is a picture, this is an old picture showing a field of opuntia or prickly pear cactus that is just dominating the whole landscape. So what researchers did is they found a pest of the prickly pear cactus, and this is one of these biocontrol super stories, right? In the New World, it was a bug that had never been described, and they called it cactoblastic cactorum, and you can't make that up. I did not name it, but it was named by the biocontrol researchers. So it was collected in South America, introduced to Australia, and did a really good job of decimating the opuntia fields that were there in Australia. Of course, there had been all sorts of, I'm sure, collateral damage, but at least it got rid of the cactus, which, as you can imagine, is just not the greatest introduced species to have. It's really a horrible species to have. So what happened is that the species, this is where the cactus moth is introduced to Australia to control prickly pear cactus, It then is moved to Southern Africa and also Mauritius, places like that. And then it's moved to the Caribbean because there are prickly pear species that grow on the beaches sometimes in those areas. And people that owned resorts wanted it controlled, so they introduced Cactoblastis cactorum here, the cactus moth. And then it jumps to Florida. It actually got to the Yucatan Peninsula, and Mexicans were freaking out, so they eradicated that small population there. But it started marching across the United States, and now it's threatening prickly pear in the United States. So this is a map showing you the suitability for Cactoblastis cactorum across this area of the United States. It also shows you where the highest densities of species are for of prickly pear cactus. So we're in real trouble. It's right on the border of Texas in this area. I'll show you a map. This is kind of the map. The latest map I could find was February 2020. So this is where it's been found. So once it's been found, like, you know, in an area like this, I mean, with invertebrates, it's already around. I mean, I love how people were like, did you know that the zebra mussels are in, you know, Lake Austin? And I was like, yes, we knew that was coming. We know it's coming. So it's kind of sad because I really don't want to see the cochineal industry decimated. And of course, in Mexico, throughout Mexico and much of Texas and throughout the United States, we eat nopal, right? And we use cochineal. So I'm hopeful that we can get it under control. So, but that's one of these questions of hubris, right? This thing that we think, oh, this is going to be easy. We can do this. And we're going to move these species around. We're going to move these exotic species around. It's going to be fine. But we have to be really cautious. And so this is a paper I thought was up at the top. This is a paper that actually is suggesting that we can use exotic species to control invasive exotic species, which I think is just a bad idea altogether, and why we need to develop these better solutions for controlling exotic species, invasive exotics. All right. So this gets into something that's just kind of become a philosophy that I embrace and a lot of people do. These are the words of Aldo Leopold, and he says, the last word in ignorance is the man who says of an animal or plant, what good is it? If the land mechanism as a whole is good, then every part is good, whether we understand it or not. If the biota in the course of eons has built something we like but do not understand, then who but a fool would discard seemingly useless parts? To keep every cog and wheel is the first precaution of intelligent tinkering. And so this is often my argument for let's keep the natives here and let's work with them. And they're underdeveloped and we can do a lot more. So speaking of intelligent tinkering, I wanna get on my soapbox a little bit here with some articles that I've been publishing lately. This is something that's really on my radar as the next big problem. So we know that in Texas, we've had perennial grasslands, and the perennial grasslands have in many places been mostly or wholesale replaced by other perennial grasses that are exotic, right, and they're homogenizing. Well, this new trend, it's not that new, it's been going on for decades, but of introducing winter annual grasses. These are non-native, and this is going on with Texas AgriLife. It was going on for what, East Texas, and now they're suggesting them for South and Southwest Texas. And I met a pig rancher recently who was just given pounds and pounds of winter annual grasses to revegetate his fields. And this is a very dangerous trend. We already have seen the conversion of wholesale perennial grasslands to annual grasslands in California. It's widely documented. If you know anything about cheatgrass, you know it's a horrible grass, and that's one that's replaced a lot of these beautiful perennial grasses all throughout the West. So this is one that I started seeing in people's yards about, I don't know, 10 years ago. And people would say, you know, what, this always happens. What is this? Like this new thing people see. So this is annual ryegrass or lolium. And this was the target grass for my first paper that I published out of my PhD that I mentioned at the top of the, the beginning of the talk. And this is an annual grass. It's introduced from the Mediterranean. It was originally introduced by Spaniards. They brought wholesale all these annual grasses to California, and it started using them for grazing, and they really systematically replaced those grasses. So this is one of the bad ones. This is a really bad one too, this wild oats. Now I love them for teaching because if you want to teach grass taxonomy, morphology, this is one of the best grasses to use because the flowers are huge and there's only a couple florets per spikelet. And they're enormous. You can see all the parts really easy, but we don't want them here. They don't belong here. And I am seeing them all over the roadsides now sticking. You'll see them in this white. They have these persistent glooms. For those of you that know grass morphology, they have persistent glooms that are very white, and you can see them when they start to dry out. But this is what they look like when they're wet. it's wild oats. You can eat it. It's oats, right? But we don't want them here. These are annual grasses from the Mediterranean, and they're going to take over. And not only when they take over, they grow and then they die because they're annuals. They don't hold the soil in place, and the soil just gets baked. This is showing you, this is a table out of that website I just showed you, showing you all these recommendations that are given through Texas AgriLife for how to grow these grasses. It's just not okay. So other things that are coming in behind those grasses are you guys probably are familiar with Malta thistle if you're paying attention. This is the next, oh, actually we found some at Hardburger, and I have to say Wendy Leonard got rid of it. She did a really good job of eradicating it locally. Then this is the worst weed ever. Yellow star thistle. If you've ever been in a field full of yellow star thistle, I mean, it is altogether worse and more spiny than, if you think Malta thistle is bad, you should feel yellow star thistle. And then bastard cabbage, and all of these are Mediterranean annual grasses. Now, I don't know what's going on. There's something going on with the climate. It's maybe that our winters are getting a little more mild, a little wetter, so they can persist through the winter. They love mild, wet winters. That's they're Mediterranean. They like that. So that's probably what's going on, something along those lines. This is what the fields look like in California. This is a totally, this one on the right here, this is all yellow star thistle. That's what it looks like when it starts coming in. It's the worst. And this is this one on the top left is cheatgrass, and this one is cheatgrass mixed with some avena or some of that oats stuff and other things. These are more Colorado type landscapes, but we really don't want these grasses. So I wrote an article that came out in the San Antonio Report about a month ago. It was August 7th, about annual grasses and keeping Texas look like Texas. And I can send anybody who'd like to have a link to it a link. So another plug for Guadalupe Gardens. Chuck wanted me to let y'all know that if you write to her at this address, info@guadalupegardens.com, you can ask her for current availability. You can place your order, and everything's going to be ready to go by October 1st. I am doing on Saturday a beer with biologists session. So if you have any other questions, you can come out there and have a beer. It's going to be from 4 to 6 in the evening out at the Guadalupe Gardens again, which is in Marion, Texas. It's about a 25-minute drive from here, from downtown San Antonio. And I'm really excited about this new development. I know we have, you know, the Native Plant Society, of course, is providing plants, but we just don't have a consistent nursery that does only natives. And also Chuck and I have talked extensively about having natives at the right time of year, right? Because like one of the best times to plant is October, November, December. And I cannot find a perennial grass to save my life to put in the ground when there's a good amount of relative humidity, so my kids just go. So that's all I got to say.